also going to be a time for, you can clap. Yeah, let's clap for Miss Joanne.
Yeah.
We are also going to let this be a time of joyful worship. So both of those things can be done today, and we're excited about the opportunity. At this time, we're going to ask Miss Emily Sorrell to come forward. She's going to open us in reading the scripture and prayer. So I'm going to ask that you would stand with us, please.
Okay, I'm uncomfortable, so bear with me. So Romans 8, 1 through 11. Therefore now there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us, who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Those who live according to the flesh have their minds set on what the flesh desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to the death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised for Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of his Spirit who lives in you. Please bow with me. Lord, we thank you so much for this time together to worship. We thank you for Pastor Shane. We pray that you bless his word as he brings it upon us. Lord, help us to live in the realm of your Spirit today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Emily. We are going to forego our time of announcements this morning, so grab a bulletin, look what's in that. I do want to add one more thing that's not in the bulletin. This Friday night, we are having a meal at our Come As You Are recovery meeting, so that'll be at 6 o'clock this Friday night. And so I'm trying to stall so the praise team will come on up. We got a lot of stuff going on this morning. Oh, the Pendergrafts are here too. We normally don't point people out, but one of the former pastors here, Chad Pendergraft, and all his crew are here. So it's good to have you here, Chad, and family. More so the family than Chad, but we are grateful for you, Chad. So I think I've stalled long enough. Y'all stand with us and we're going to worship together.
That's the truth. Good morning. It is a great day to be in God's house. We've got some exciting things happening today, and that starts with worshiping together. And we just ask you to shake hands with the people around you, tell one another hello, and join us in worship. You can go. Thank you.
blessings flow. Praise Him, praise Him, for the wonders of His love. Praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him. For God so loved the world that He gave us His one and only Son to save us. God so loved the world that He gave us His one and only Son to save us. The power of hell forever defeated now is well. I'm walking in freedom. God so loved, God so loved the world. Bring all your failures, bring your addictions. Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
Adore Him. Oh, come. us adore Him, Christ the Lord.
Thank you. You can be seated. As the ushers come forward, I just want us to think about those words, "Oh, come, let us adore Him." We, as unworthy people outside of Christ, get to come before the King and adore Him, and He receives us because of what Jesus has done. So at this time, we're going to have our time of offering. As we always say, take this time to remember how God has blessed you. Give as a cheerful giver, give as a biblical giver, and also think about the generosity that God calls us to display, not just at church, but in every part of our life. So let's pray together. God, thank you for your goodness in the way that you've blessed us as individuals. Thank the way that you have blessed us as a group of people who come together that make up Split Log Baptist Church. Thank you for the things that you're doing through this community, but it's you, and we give you all the glory for that. You get all of the credit for all of those things. So thank you again. Help us to give, help us to be generous, help us to serve, and help us to glorify you in all we do. In Jesus' name, amen. As they are taking up offering, I'm going to call an audible here. As they're taking up offering, I'm going to explain Advent because I've had a lot of questions lately. And then in just a moment, I'm going to have Jason and Leisha come up to lead us in the reading. But what is Advent? You know, we light these candles up here and people say, "I don't even know what that's about." I've heard that a lot. I hear it a lot every year that we celebrate Advent. Well, Christmas, we celebrate the birth of Christ. Advent, we celebrate the fact that Jesus is coming back, that He died, He rose, and He is right now at the right hand of the Father. But in the future, He is literally coming back. And so Christmas, not in the Bible, other than it tells us that Jesus was born. Same with Advent. The celebration of Advent is not in the Bible, except for the fact that it tells us very clearly Jesus is coming back. So why do we do the Advent wreath? Jason, Alicia, y'all can come on up at this time. Why do we do the Advent wreath? It's an object lesson. There's nothing spiritual about it. There's nothing holy about it. They're just candles, probably bought them at Dollar General or Dollar Tree. You're going to hear the glorious click of a lighter in a moment. This is not holy fire. It comes from a Bic lighter. It is just an object lesson that we use to remind ourselves that Jesus is the light of the world. He already is, and He's coming back. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Jason and Alicia, who will lead us in our time of Advent celebration.
However, today we know that we know and celebrate that Jesus will return and will finish what He started. That God has done what no one else and nothing else could do by sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin He committed sin in the flesh so that we can joyfully walk according to the Spirit. I ask you that you stand and celebrate with me as we awake God's final victory. I will read the light print, and I will ask you to read the bold print along with me. As we consider that Jesus has set us free from condemnation, we gather in preparation. We gather in expectation. We gather in celebration. With preparation and expectation, let us worship. You may be seated. The Advent wreath is a symbol of the unceasing love of God revealed to us in His Word. We light candles to symbolize the light coming through the law. through the prophets and in all the God's holy word. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. And the one who follows me will not walk in the darkness, but will have the light of life. We light these candles as a sign of the coming light of Christ. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light, and those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. Isaiah 9:2.
No. If y'all don't know what else God can do, just look at Jason. I used to know the old Jason, and he used to know the old Travis, and God's pretty incredible. So.
I'm singing hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Thank you.
Son. And God, this time of year, we just sit in awe, and we also sit in expectation, God. We're in awe of what you've done for us and the sacrifice that you made. God, we are in hopeful expectation for your return, God. We just ask that in the rest of this time, everything that is said and done in this place will be to honor and glorify you. We thank you for the celebrations that we're going to have in this place today. God, we thank you for the service that is on display, service for your kingdom. God, we ask you would be with Shan as he brings your word, that you would just speak through him. God, that we would have open hearts for what you have for us today. We love you so much, and we ask these things in Jesus' precious and perfect and holy name. Amen.
We ask that you be seated, and before we dismiss our children to Children's Church, because we want people to be able to be a part of how we honor Miss Joanne, I just want to let you know who she is. Miss Joanne Crosby is back there. She's probably not going to stand up, but Ed will, and that's Miss Joanne. She has served here. This has been her only church. Father was the only treasurer that we've had other than her, and she has served here in that capacity for 52 years. And one of the reasons that we're honoring her today is because there's a little place in the Bible where it talks about those who serve and those who serve the church, and then it says to honor men such as these. And so we want to honor Miss Joanne this morning. We're going to start out with a video, and then we are going to have a couple of people who have known her for a long, long time come and honor her as well. And so if you're new here and you think, I don't even know Miss Joanne, just know that she's a very special lady, and she serves in the way that we should all aspire to. So she is an example of service to the kingdom, and I'm not supposed to speak personally, but I want to say, Miss Joanne, thank you for what you've meant to my family. Thank you for what you've meant to this church. You are a true blessing. So with that, we're going to start with this video, and then we will continue from there. Thank you. We want to say that we love you, Miss Joanne, but we know that you have loved this church a lot deeper than a lot of us ever could. And so you have been instrumental in what this church has become. And we know we give all glory to God for that, but we thank you for your faithfulness, for being such an instrumental part of the history of Splitlock Baptist Church. And speaking of instrumental in the history of Splitlock Baptist Church, we have a couple of people who are going to come speak in honor of Miss Joanne. And I don't know which one of you is going first. Miss Margaret. This is Miss Margaret Hall. She's going to come forward. Oh, and we're getting Miss Joanne up here too. Excellent.
So this is how the church looked when you became church treasurer in 1969. The church was organized in 1933, and Joanne's brother Shannon already may mention this. Joanne's mother and dad, Earl and Ella Campbell, were charter members. They were one of the. They were among the 12 people that were the first members here at Splitlock. Joanne's been a close family friend through the years. She was like a sister that my mother-in-law never had. She was in their wedding. She was the flower girl. In 1942, when my mother and father-in-law were married over in the Little Rock Church, that was the first wedding performed at Splitlock Baptist Church. And so that makes Joanne the first flower girl ever at Splitlock Baptist Church. I think it's interesting, too, that Joanne, her entire life, has lived within 2 miles of Splitlock Baptist Church. That's quite an honor. That's amazing, Joanne. So Joanne knows Splitlock Baptist Church like no other person. Joanne also faithfully played the piano for years at Splitlock, and it was Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. She didn't miss. If the doors were open, Joanne was here. I know that as church treasurer, it sounds like an easy job. It's like count the money and take it to the bank. It's more than that. She spent hours every Sunday. And I think that comes up to like 2,700 Sundays for 52 years. So, you know, she served on the budget and finance committee. She diligently watched the budgets and kept everything in line. She kept immaculate books, I can assure you. Joanne, your faithfulness and your commitment is an inspiration to all of us. The church wants to present you with this copy of an original oil painting that my mom, Estelle Stout, did. I think she painted it about 1990. So that's for you, Joanne. That's yours. Yeah. Splitlock Baptist Church has been blessed immensely by God through the years. And not too long ago, I was telling a friend about the things that God's doing at Splitlock Baptist Church. And he said, somebody must have really prayed for Splitlock. And I said, yes, they did. He said, you know, our prayers don't expire. So we still go forward experiencing God's blessings on Splitlock Baptist Church. And we want to thank you for all you've done to contribute to all of that and your faithfulness through the years. Joanne, we love you.
God bless. And now we're going to have Warren Townsend. He did a little bit of everything here too. He was just instrumental in a lot of things, so we're grateful that he's here. We still consider him one of ours, even though his son is the pastor at First Baptist Goodman and he supports him over there. We're glad that Warren's here. He'll always be a part of our family. And he saw a lot of things that Joanne did that you and I will never know in ways that she sacrificed for this church. So just what Margaret said, this was not an easy job. If you think treasurer was an easy job, it's absolutely not. And so with that, I'm going to hand it over to... Okay, I'm going to keep talking then. One of the things that I'm so grateful to Miss Joanne for is her faithfulness, the way that she just didn't miss. Even since I've been here, she just doesn't miss. And she's one of those people that doesn't hide in the background. She's willing to work in the background. This is probably the most attention you've ever wanted, but here it is today. And we are just, because we just want you to know how grateful we are for the way that you've served God.
Isn't it good to be in God's house this morning? It is such an honor for me to be able to come and speak about Joanne's leadership and service for 52 years. You know, it says in Ephesians 4, verses 1, "Therefore, the Lord beseech ye that you walk worthy of the vocation wherein you are called." And definitely she was called to lead us financially. If you look back, Joanne, you have led us from when we were in the Rock Church. We had 35 people. We could barely make budget to pay a part-time pastor. And the good thing was Joanne never tried to hold the church back. She'd just tell us where we needed to be in order to fulfill God's will. Then there was the time when we got some money and reinvented the Rock Church. We were so blessed. Then we went to a full-time pastor with Mr. Chad. And, you know, she sat down and she said, "This will be what your costs are." She never once looked and said, "Oh, that's too much." And that's because Joanne understood that in Matthew it talks about the Great Commission, right? What our duty is the Great Commission. And she continued to lead there. Then we added the classrooms before we ever thought about it, the adding of the church here. Then 20 years ago, we bought the house over there that is now your administration building. And, you know, that was a lot of money. Joanne never once held us back. She said, "This is where you have to be to get there." Then come the time, and Chad will remember, we sat across in the Rock Church and we had a vote of, would we build this new church? Right, Chad? Joanne was there. She supported us. You know, that was a tough time. When you look, we're sitting in that little bitty Rock Church. Sometimes we might get 50 or 60 on Sunday morning, and yet we were going to build this church. And then the devil threw everything he could at us. The building fell 3 times during construction. Joanne never once wavered and said, "Maybe we shouldn't do it." She was there to support us all along as our financial leader. You know, she has foresight. If you look at the great things about Joanne, you look back and you go, well, what is it? And it's her core values. Her core values in the Great Commission. Her core values of understanding and the foresight. You'd say, well, it's just the accuracy and and accountability of the job. It was rough. You know, when we sat in the Little Rock Church, Joanne, we didn't have computers, and Joanne had to read the business statement every month. All the line item expenses. Chad and us sit down because, you know, Joanne's voice was just giving out. We had so many expenses and knew it was going to grow. And Chad and I sat down and we go, what can we do to help her? And we got it changed. So now you know, she helped us develop a program where we weren't being limited. You know, too often a treasurer of a church holds the church back and limits it. And she never did that. She helped lead us and guide us to what the Great Commission had for us. But her core character, you know, she's a positive minister. She's a role model. Her values, you trusted whatever Joanne was. Whatever she said, the numbers come through. And it may have been because she was trained from her dad and then her early years of having to read each one. But she is one of the only treasurers I've ever known that could tell you why we have that line item on the budget, how much we spent, how much we have left, and what we're going to be able to do for God's work and what's the money that's left. So we have been very blessed with her. The key is the confidentiality, because you look, Joanne is so confidential, she would not tell things. And quite often, churches have treasurers who are gossip hounds. It's bad to say, but Joanne is confidential. And it was the great thing that helped us in the building of this church, because there was donations made, there was pledges, and they would take an envelope to Joanne, and there would be money in the fund. It's like when we built the garage barn over here. We announced it on a Sunday morning, right, John, that we needed it. And the donations started coming in. They went to Joanne, and God's will was done. We are so blessed that she led us in that manner. But her foresight from the Little Rock Church to the administration building to this church is what helped us grow in God's will. And she always kept our missions, made us clear of what our mission fund would be at Christmas and at Easter. And she was the first to come up and offer that we need to donate to the Knoll Church. You know, missions are close and missions are far away. But she understood that, and we were valuable. If you look back and you understand the purpose, one of the key verses is Philippians 4:8 about Joanne. And it says, "Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, and whatsoever things are pure and good, virtue and praise for God." That is Joanne. Joanne, thank you for your time of service and for all the mentoring you have done to us who needed it. Let's recognize Joanne one more time.
Thank you, Warren. Thank you, Miss Margaret. And thank you again, Joanne. And something that Warren said, I want to highlight one more time. There was no sense of entitlement from Miss Joanne. When you have the daughter of charter members whose dad was the treasurer and who has been the treasurer for so long, usually in rural churches, what you get is someone who says, "We're going to do things my way. We're going to keep the church the way I like it." But before I got here, there were things that changed this church immensely. And one of those things was children ministry and van ministry. When you bring children in whose parents don't come with them, you invite a whole bunch of problems and dirtiness and all those things that some churches say, "Hey, we're not going to do that." And Joanne was one of many of our senior citizens who did not stand in the way. And then when we started a recovery ministry, I didn't have anything to do with that. That was the Holy Spirit and a crazy man that God brought in off the street to us. When things were uncomfortable, we're like, "I don't know how this is going to turn out." Never once were we held back by Miss Joanne or any of the others. And so, Miss Joanne, thank you for being one of the pillars of this church. And we look forward to you continuing to be a pillar of this church, and we're grateful for your continued influence. So with that, let me pray, and we will end this time of recognition, and we'll move on with the rest of the worship service. God, thank you for your kindness to us. Thank you that you love us like you do by sending us people like Miss Joanne. Thank you for all of those in her family who have supported her, who are here today. And we pray that you would continue to raise up laborers in the harvest. You have given us and will continue to give us, Miss Joanne. Thank you that you promise us that as we continue to pray, that you would raise up those laborers, that you'll send them. So thank you for your faithfulness to Split Log Baptist Church. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, we'll dismiss our children to Children's Church. That is 3 years old through the fourth grade, and there will be responsible adults go with them. If you want them to stay up here, you are welcome to keep them up here. If you would rather them go downstairs, that is totally permissible as well. Also want to, as the kids are going out, I want to remind you about a few things. This Friday night at Come As You Are, there will be a Christmas Eve meal. You're welcome to that. This Thursday night, there's a candlelight service at 7. And then tonight, there is, we don't even know what to call it, but a bunch of people are getting together and we're going to sing Christmas songs. We're going to hear people sing Christmas songs. And then right after the service today, we're going to have a reception for Miss Joanne. There's also going to be a youth fundraiser lunch. So they're providing the food. If you feel led to donate to that, That will help our youth go on mission, and it will also give us a great opportunity to fellowship with Miss Joanne. So at this time, we're going to be turning in the book of Romans to Romans chapter 8. So if you want to go ahead and be turning there, we want to remember the context of Romans to where we have been to this point and what it's been looking like. Romans is one of the most rewarding and helpful books of the Bible. And we know a lot about the gospel and the clarity of the gospel and what it means to be a believer and what grace is because of the Holy Spirit inspired Paul to write this book for us and preserve this book for us to be read as authoritative scripture. Now, we just got done with Romans 7, and Romans 7 is difficult. Well, it doesn't get a lot easier in Romans 8. But here's something I want to remind you that we say all the time. Remember that when you are reading the Bible, if you're reading through Romans, you get to Romans 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. You're like, I don't know what's going on here. Remember, when you are reading the Bible, the main things are the plain things, and the plain things are the main things. And another, it's a cliche, but it's a helpful one, is major in the majors. Don't major in the minors. Don't get lost in looking at the road signs. Look to where those road signs point us to. So the Bible is pointing us to redemption through God's plan. In the Old Testament, it was the coming Messiah. It was God showing himself who he was through the way he revealed himself to Israel. And then he reveals himself through Jesus Christ perfectly. And so we know that the major things are pointing to God's redemption. Ultimately, that is Jesus. So when you're reading the Bible, don't get bogged down in details. Keep looking for where the road signs are pointing. Because if we don't, it would be as silly as this. Imagine a lot of people here, when you go on vacation, you go to Colorado. Imagine going to Colorado. You've never been there before. You go to Colorado. You get to the state line, and you do what we did when we moved to Missouri. We all piled out of the car, and we had our picture made in front of the Missouri sign. So maybe you do that in Colorado. You pile out of the car, and you all get your picture taken there. You share some fun facts about Colorado. You talk about the history of the state. You talk about the importance of Colorado to the American experience, maybe even the economy. But then, instead of experiencing Colorado, instead of seeing Colorado and enjoying Colorado, you all get back in the car and you turn around and you come back to Southwest Missouri. People say, what'd you do on your vacation? We went and saw the road sign at Colorado. People say, well, why didn't you go into Colorado? Because, man, I love that road sign. It's one of the most beautiful welcome signs in all of the 50 states. It's just, it's amazing. And I want to focus on that road sign. And we said, but did you even get to Pikes Peak? Did you even see that part? Did you get on the other side of Pikes Peak where it really gets beautiful? No. Let's talk about the road sign. And sometimes Paul talks about that. He said there are people who want to talk about the road signs, and they want to find the details, and they want to argue over details instead of saying, this road sign points us to the reward of Jesus Christ. So when you're reading through Romans, you get to some road signs that sometimes you don't know where they're pointing you. Continue to let them point you to Jesus Christ, knowing that the Bible, in its totality, points us toward redemption through Jesus Christ. So don't lose the plot by focusing on things that weren't meant to be the focal points. So the reason I say that is because as we finish Romans 7 and we get to 8, 9, 10, 11, things get more and more difficult. There's a lot of answers I'm not going to be able to give you, but I want you to read and I want you to keep your eyes on what God is calling us to do. So that's the kind of thing we want to do with the Bible. And now let's look at Romans chapter 8, verse 1, and then we'll get into a little bit of the context. Verse 1, one of the most well-known verses in the Bible. And for good reason. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So that therefore reminds us that we need to look and see what's been happening. And Paul has been talking about how the law, rule-keeping, rule-following, could not and was never intended to save people from their sins. Being a good person can never save you from your sin because you can't be good enough to undo the sins that you've committed. Following one law won't undo our disobedience of another law. And so the law brings death. But the law is good, Paul has told us, because it makes us aware of our sin, and it lets us know that we have a desperate need for a God intervention, a God rescue. And Christmas is one of those huge milestones in that plan to rescue sinful humanity, because, as we're going to see here, God became like one of us in every way, yet was without sin. God set us free from sin because his grace through the cross. He came as a person. As we sang this morning, he came as a baby boy, but he grew up to be a man, and he lived perfectly, and he fulfilled all of the law
He obeyed every one of God's laws perfectly, never sinned, and then he died. And because he was perfect, he was the worthy sacrifice for us, so that my imperfection and condemnation could be put on Jesus. And everyone who will come to him in repentance and faith, their condemnation has been placed on Jesus, and he was condemned on the cross. And all of the wrath of God was poured out on him, so that we might be given in the place of condemnation the righteousness of Christ. And so that was a swap that was really in our favor, right? And Jesus had to suffer for that. But because of what Jesus has done, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. It means that there is no damnation, there is no eternal wrath, there is no fear for your future when you're saved as a Christian. And we'll talk about what Romans 8:4 in just a moment tells us what a Christian is. As a Christian, when you die, it will be gain, Paul says. You'll die and you'll be in God's presence. And you'll be in God's presence in heaven until Jesus returns. And at that point, the resurrection will happen. And look, I'm not giving you a timeline for end times. I have no idea. God's going to do something perfect at the end of the days. And I'm a little foggy on the details, but he isn't, and it's going to be perfect. So we will be with him. There isn't condemnation. In fact, there's the opposite. Instead of condemnation that we deserve, we get a reward. Instead of God's wrath that we deserve, there's love. While you were a sinner, Romans says, Christ died for you. And this is the glorious news of Christmas, of Advent, of every other part of the year that reminds us of God. He doesn't merely tolerate you. God does not merely tolerate you. He didn't just save you and move on. His love continues. There's this joke about married people who say, I don't tell my spouse I love them. At least I hope this is a joke. It says, I told you I was committed to you on our wedding day. I told you I loved you on our wedding day. I'll let you know if anything changes. And that's a joke, I hope. I hope that's a joke of saying, look, that's the reason I don't tell you I love you, because nothing changed. But I hope that's a joke, because who would want to be in a marriage without the affirmation of being told that they're loved? In a loving marriage, there's genuine care and affection. And in the same way, God's love for you is not merely some cold truth that purchases your ticket to heaven. It is a truth. It's a fact. But it's more than that. God's love and his pure grace continues. And God has true and perfect affection for you. He loves you so much that he will insist upon the truth. He will command you to obey him. But he doesn't only tolerate you, he loves you. If you want to check me out here, read Philippians 1:8 and see what it says about loving people with the affection of Christ. If you also want more proof that Jesus loves you, you can see Jesus' affection for his people as he looks at Jerusalem and he weeps over Jerusalem. And then look back to the Old Testament, where the prophet uses poetic phrases like Zephaniah 3:17, the Lord, your God, is with you, the mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you. That's talking about the Almighty God and how he feels about us, broken, busted sinners. He will delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you. He will rejoice over you with singing. I don't know how literal that is. I don't know if someday God is going to sing over me, but that's how much he loves me. Why does he love me? What did I do to deserve that love? Absolutely nothing. And if my wife was in this room, she went downstairs to help with children's church. If she was in here, she would go, amen. He has done nothing deserving of God's love. I haven't even done anything deserving of Dana's love. She loves me out of a sense of commitment, sometimes obligation, but she loves me. God, on the other hand, loves you perfectly in a way that the best earthly mother or father could not possibly love you. God loves you in a way that the best possible spouse on earth could ever love you. And so that Zephaniah passage is a beautiful Old Testament counterpart to what Romans 8:1 tells us. Because of his grace, you will no longer be condemned. But what Romans is going to get to very quickly in the next few verses, I want to go ahead and say it, is this does not apply to everyone in the world. That's what a lot of people want to say now, is that God loves everyone. He's going to take condemnation away from everyone. God wants everyone to come to him and be saved. But not everyone is free from the condemnation of God, because not everyone has received the freedom from condemnation, because the only way you can be free from that condemnation is in Jesus Christ. And that's much more than just saying a prayer or getting baptized or doing the church thing. It is seeing the evidence of the Holy Spirit guiding you, the Holy Spirit indwelling you and guiding you. So notice this very clear truth. There's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, which also lets us know that the opposite is true. There is condemnation for those who are not in Christ. Why? Because we're all guilty. We're all condemned. All humans have sinned. And because of that, the Bible tells us that we deserve condemnation. That's not me saying that. I'm not looking at you and saying you deserve condemnation because Shan thinks so. I'm saying we all deserve condemnation because God says so. But there is a way out, and that way is Jesus. Look at verse 2. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. Christ has set us free from being good enough to earn our salvation because we can't do that. And instead, he has given us the law of the Spirit of life. Well, what does that phrase mean? This is one of those parts, and we're getting to another one of those parts, just like chapter 7, in Romans, where sometimes Paul says some things, and we agree with what St. Peter said when he wrote. He said, sometimes Brother Paul says things, and it's confusing. It's hard to understand. That was St. Peter, the apostle, said that. And so we understand sometimes, well, what exactly does this mean? Well, it at least means this. The Holy Spirit is going to direct our lives because the Holy Spirit lives in us. That's what makes a Christian a Christian. Yes, we receive the grace of Jesus Christ. We believe his birth and death and resurrection. We believe that he's coming back. But what seals us as Christians is the Holy Spirit living in us, which happens to everyone who comes to him in true repentance and faith. So sin and death are no longer the way of life for us. Yes, Christian, you probably sinned this week. And if you tell me that you didn't, I will accuse you of lying, which is a sin. So you probably sinned this week, but sin is no longer what we have to do. It's no longer our destiny or our future. We can have life. And that doesn't just mean physical life. It means abundant spiritual life. We always want to be clear, this does not mean abundant financial prosperity. The Bible does not promise you that if you come to him, your life is going to be a peaceful, easy feeling. It is going to sometimes be difficult, but it means abundant spiritual joy and peace because you and I, deserving of condemnation, have been set free because of what God has done by sending Jesus. Look at verse 3. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. By sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. This is the message of Christmas. We talked about last week, Christmas cheer. There's nothing wrong with that. Caroling, I enjoyed it. I loved it. I've never enjoyed it before, but apparently if you put some Jesus in there, it makes things better. That was a joke. It always makes things better. But anyway, there's nothing wrong with those things. But the point of Christmas is that Jesus came in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin. And in doing that, he condemned your sin and gives you righteousness. Imputed righteousness, which means righteousness that you didn't earn has been miraculously taken from Jesus, who offered himself and has been put on you. So when God looks at you, he sees righteousness. And this is not my phrase. This is I didn't make this up because it's a weird way to put it, but it's called alien righteousness, not the kind of aliens, but outside of us where it's alien, and a righteousness that isn't mine comes on me from Jesus Christ and then enables me to live a life of righteousness for his glory. So it's all something that God does. It's not what we do. And so by sending his own son, he Christmased us. I know I took a noun and made it into a verb because I don't always respect English rules because some of them I don't like. But anyway, he Christmased us. So here in this very theologically packed chapter of Romans 8, we get a Christmas message. God sent his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin. He was born in poverty. That was very common to the people of that day. But he didn't even get the usual home birth. They were traveling 80 miles on a donkey. Ladies, full term, 80 miles on a beast of burden. We don't know that it's a donkey, but they traveled somehow. Maybe we do know that it's a donkey. Anyway, Christmas songs confuse me. Sometimes it's in the Bible. Sometimes it's just in a Christmas song. The Bible's authoritative. The Christmas songs are not. So they were traveling these 80 miles because of a decree of the reigning superpower that was known for oppressing anyone who crossed them. And so he was born in humble circumstances. And a while after he was born, he had to go on the run to keep from being slaughtered by a crazy bureaucrat named Herod. He took on a body and a life that wasn't easy. He wasn't a privileged kid. He was raised in the home of a laborer. God came to us in Christ in such a remarkable way that when people saw these prophecies in the Old Testament, the religious people of that day said, well, we don't know how it's going to be, but it's going to be awesome and it's going to be glorious, and he is just going to destroy our enemies. And then when Jesus came and he was born in a feeding trough, and when he was the son of a carpenter, and when he walked around poor and hung out with people that were considered outcasts of the day, the religious establishment said, look, that's not what the Messiah is going to look like. The Messiah is going to be awesome. He's going to be a winner. He's going to do so much winning. And then Jesus comes, and he looks a lot different than people were expecting. But as you read the Old Testament in light of Jesus, you realize that he looks exactly like the Old Testament said that he would look. And so many people missed it. They were religious. They were very religious. They did the church thing all the time. They called it temple. They called it synagogue. But they did the church thing all the time. And they still missed it. We don't want to miss it. The Holy Spirit is speaking to us and saying, believe in Jesus Christ and follow him. That is the reason that Split Log is what it is. It isn't because of programs. It isn't even because of Miss Joanne. It is because of the work that God has done through people like Miss Joanne. And we're grateful for that, but she would be the first to tell you. Actually, when you do thank her for things, she goes, oh. She doesn't even say anything after that. It's like, don't make it weird. She doesn't say that part. I'm filling in there. She doesn't like the attention. She knows that everything that's happened here is not because of human effort. It is because of God doing the work. And he sent his son to come do this work in our hearts. And because he lived and died and rose again the way he did, only he was worthy. And only he is able to condemn sin in the flesh. So at one time, we all were condemned. But because of Christ, if you're a believer, if you are a Christian, if you are guided by the Spirit, our sin is condemned and we are set free. Can you imagine that feeling? You see these stories a lot where someone has been wrongly imprisoned. But forget that. Think about the idea of someone who deserved to be in prison. I mean, deserved every bit of it, deserved the death penalty. And then somebody comes along and says, hey, I'm going to take that penalty for you. You are now free to go. Can you imagine the excitement? Now, just imagine the excitement of those people who were wrongly convicted and wrongly in prison. And when they are set free, the news goes and talks to them, and they just talk about how amazing it is to be free, and their family is celebrating. Now think about the condemnation and the imprisonment, that the eternal imprisonment that we deserved. And Jesus said, along with the plan of the Father and the Holy Spirit, said, I don't want you to have to suffer that. I will suffer that for you. And instead of that condemnation that you rightfully deserve, I'm going to give you freedom. I'm going to give you forgiveness. I'm going to give you eternal life. That's what Jesus has done. Now look at verse 4. In order that, let me read verse 3 again. So we get the idea. By sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin to deal with the sin problem, he condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us. And then here's a very important line. Who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So Jesus did what he did because we couldn't do it. So that he could give us his righteousness. And the law is considered to be fulfilled in us because Jesus fulfilled it and then gave that to us. But this is for people. The people who are not condemned are not people who know the answer to Sunday school questions. Lost people can know the answer to Sunday school questions. Judas, the betrayer, was one of Jesus' 12 apostles. You know, Jesus had hundreds of disciples at one point. Even after his crucifixion and resurrection, he had 120 that were gathered together in the upper room. But he chose Judas to be one of the inner circle, one of the 12. Judas knew the answers, and yet he betrayed Jesus. He was an enemy of Jesus. So how do you know if you're saved? Well, do you believe the gospel? Do you trust in Jesus by faith? Good. So do demons. They don't trust in Jesus by faith. Let me repeat that. That is not true. Do you believe the gospel? Good. The demons do too. So a mere head belief is not enough. Do you trust in Jesus by faith? Well, if you want to answer yes to that, we have to ask the question, what is the evidence of our salvation? It's not our behavior as much as it is that we walk according to the Spirit. But if the Spirit lives in you and guiding you, your behavior is going to be different. Just like when I'm at home My kids behave a certain way. They know the rule. Don't bring the cats in the house. They know that rule. And when I'm there, they don't try to pull that on me too much. But Dana and I had to go to Joplin yesterday, and we left the little girls with my son, who's old enough to babysit. Don't hotline me. And we get a text, hey, the cats are downstairs in the basement because the girls brought them in. Yeah, of course they are. Now, the reason I use that is merely as an illustration. If we are filled by the Spirit and we know, we are aware that the Holy Spirit is with us and we know that His rules will lead us to joy and life and peace, then we're going to do that. But if we pretend like He isn't there, we're going to behave another way. But what Paul is saying is that Christians live according to the Spirit and not according to the flesh. I like the way that William Hendrickson puts it. Paul states that if anyone's life marks him as lacking Christ's Spirit, he has no right to consider himself a Christian. Now, there is no condemnation for the one who is in Jesus Christ, but the one who is in Jesus Christ is the one who walks not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Now, you might be thinking, Shan, that sounds a little bit like works righteousness. It isn't. It isn't at all. And if you've understood that from what I've said, then I apologize for my lack of clarity. It isn't because of what we do that saves us. We are not saved by our effort, but God is not opposed to our effort once we've been saved. Once we've been saved by the pure grace of Jesus Christ as a gift, He says, now live for me, for my glory, and it will bring you joy. Look at verse 5. Why should we do that? Ask yourself this question. Why should I live according to the Spirit? Verse 5. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. When we live for our desires rather than God's desires for us, it's evidence for us to see that we are still in desperate need of salvation by grace. Because if we are saved, we have the Holy Spirit, and we will be pulled by the Holy Spirit to live according to the guidance of the Holy Spirit. If we live according to the Holy Spirit, our minds are going to increasingly be on what He wants. And that's what's best for His glory and our joy on this earth. There, back several years ago, and maybe there are some people who still think this now, but there was this thing that would go around that say, look, there's the Spirit-filled Christian and there's the carnal Christian. The Spirit-filled Christian is someone who's like, they're the top tier of Christians. They're the ones who take it seriously and actually want to grow and be discipled. But then there's these other people who just believe God, and they're saved, but they're carnal Christians, still living in the flesh. If that was the case, Paul never knew about those people. Paul never knew about those people. I think I've even said this before in my past, and hopefully it was a distant past. I said something like this, and I'm just making up ages. But I've heard people say this too. I was saved when I was 12. I made Him my Savior then, but I didn't make Him my Lord until my 30s. Well, let's be as clear as the Holy Spirit is through Paul on this. You didn't get saved until you were filled with the Holy Spirit. You didn't get saved until you made Jesus your Lord. And I also want to point out that the Bible makes no distinction between when you make Jesus your Lord and when you are indwelt by the Holy Spirit. When you make Jesus your Lord, the Holy Spirit comes and indwells your heart, even if you don't always feel a tingly feeling. This morning, I have not felt great because it's Sunday. I'm not sick. It's just Sunday. I got some stress. I wake up and I think there's a lot of stuff to do and a lot of things for me not to forget. And I wake up and I go through a lot of routines on Sunday mornings, and I do not feel the Holy Spirit in me. And sometimes when we sing songs, I go, that is true. Yes, I'm grateful that's true. But it doesn't make me want to dance. It's okay if you dance. You're welcome to dance here. But it doesn't excite me sometimes. That's okay. It doesn't change the fact that the Holy Spirit dwells in those who have made Christ. So if you say, I accepted Jesus as my Savior, I'm just not taking Him seriously yet, Paul would just say you're not a believer. Paul would say that you're not a Christian. But Paul would also say that God wants to save you. And God wants to bring you to Him and have you be His child. Jesus wants to be your Lord. So if you have not made Jesus your Lord, He is not your Savior. So what does that mean then? If we sin, does it mean that we're not saved? No, not necessarily. Maybe, but not necessarily. So if you're confused by that, hold on. Do not live your life according to the flesh. Do you? Or do you live it according to the Spirit? Do you aim to please God with your life, or are you happy with just seeking your own pleasure? But in this, we also want to have all the nuance that Paul had. Don't only look at a pattern of behavior to determine if you're saved, because your behavior can't save you. I mean, if anybody could be saved, I hope this is okay for me to say, Miss Joanne, but if anybody could be saved at this church on the basis of works, it would be Miss Joanne. But she knows the truth of the Bible, that all of the many things that she has done that we are honoring her for, none of those things come close to earning a spot for her in heaven. The only thing that saves us is Jesus Christ. So don't only look at a pattern of behavior. There must be evidence of Jesus in your life, evidence of a changed life. How else can we know that we're not condemned? Are you convicted of sin? Do you then repent of that sin? Then you're doing what Christians do because of the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. But do you ignore conviction? Do you just do that thing, that church thing, where you ask for forgiveness with no intention of actually turning around in repentance? Then you're doing what the unregenerate, not born again, lost people do, because they don't have the Spirit. Verse 6 keeps helping us understand this. For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the life, on the Spirit, is life and peace. Again, a mind set on the flesh means a rebellious attitude toward God, where we ignore Him and we dismiss His guidance and His commandments, and we do what we want even when it's sinful. But a mind that is increasingly directed Godward will result in a life of peace. Not always comfort, not earthly comfort, but it will bring spiritual comfort. Look at verse 7. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. If you are not a believer, you might want to say, well, I'm just not interested in God. What the Bible says is you hate Him. And you might resist that. You say, I don't hate God. The Bible says that your flesh, you are hostile towards God. And what higher degree of hate is there than indifference? I'm just indifferent toward God. Okay, well, God takes that as hatred. The mind that's set on the flesh is hostile to God. The mind that does whatever they want without thinking about God is hostile to God. For it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. So unrepentant sinners hate God. Again, William Hendrickson says this: those who live according to the flesh allow their lives to be basically determined by the sinful desires of the human nature. Those unregenerate live according to the flesh, they set their minds on, are the most interested in, are the most engaged about the things that pertain to the flesh and the sinful nature. But those who live according to the Spirit, and therefore submit to the Spirit's direction, concentrate their attention on and specialize in whatever is dear to the Spirit. So in the conflict between God and human sinful nature, the saved person sides with God and the unregenerate person sides with human nature. So we have to ask ourselves, does Romans 8:1 apply to me? Is there no condemnation? Am I following God? Am I seeking Him? Am I filled with His Spirit? Am I saved? Am I truly saved? Not. Don't ask yourself the question, did I pray that prayer? Did I do that thing? But have I accepted Jesus as my Lord, the one who gets to tell me what to do? Verse 8, those who are in the flesh cannot please God. Living by our rules, even if they are highly religious and churchified rules, it's an absolute impossibility for us to please God, because you can't unbreak a law. If I get pulled over for running a stop sign, which I'm not saying has or has not happened, it's just, you know, hypothetically. If I get pulled over for running a stop sign and he says, you ran that stop sign, what if I said this? Yes, I admit that I did that. But I'd stopped at like 17 stop signs before that. What does that get me? As he's writing the ticket, he says, nowhere. But you don't understand. I'm a good person. I'm a law follower. I stopped at red lights and stop signs. I have done the speed limit for the most part. And I have done these things. And he says, yes, I know, but you ran that stop sign. Well, can't you just unbreak that law for me? No, that's not how the law works. Now, I understand that in real life, you might come across a policeman who will fall for that. And they'll say, okay, you know, go on, just stop doing it. You might. But God is perfectly holy and just, and when we break His law, He knows and tells us in the Scripture that we are lawbreakers and we are condemned. Because our sins are not merely running a stop sign. Our sins are rebellion against the most high and holy God of the universe. And when we do that, we have rejected his authority, we have broken his law, and we can't unbreak the law. But what Jesus can do for us is fulfill the law in righteousness and then give us his righteousness. And then in that, he takes our condemnation and puts it on himself. And he's already dealt with it. Jesus is not still suffering for my, but he's not anymore because his once for all sacrifice has taken care of. You can't please God by being good because you can't unsin. You can't fall. But there is this, however, look at verse 9. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. In fact, the spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the spirit of God does not belong to him. Let's continue to read verses 10 and 11. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the spirit is life because of righteousness. And if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. There's a lot in those verses, and we could spend 2-3 Sundays on those verses, but we're going to spend a couple minutes. If Christ is in you, you will have life because of the Holy Spirit, even though you know that your body is already dying. Now, if you're 15, you may not know your body is decaying. But let me tell you, at least by 43, you will have some evidence that your body is decaying. Because you stand up out of a chair and you go, oh, that hurts. What did I do? I sat for too long. That's what I did. And now that hurts. And it is a reminder, a daily reminder, that this flesh is passing away and that we have to be living for something more or none of this matters. We have to be living for something eternal, and that eternal is going to happen after we die. And then after we die, we're going to be in the presence of God if we are true Christians. And by true Christians, I don't mean better than somebody else. I mean we have the Holy Spirit dwelling in us. And then when Jesus returns, we're going to spend eternity in his presence. So our bodies are going to go through decay. We're going to die, but that is not the end. That's the reason we can have hope. That's the reason Paul can say that even though people have passed away, we don't have to mourn like those who have no hope. That's the reason he can say, when I die, it will be gain. It will be a promotion. It will be a homegoing. We will, though, have ups and downs. I don't want you to misunderstand this and think, wow, I must not be a Christian because I still sin. The idea that a believer, once he comes to Christ, is always just on an even keel, is always happy, is always ecstatic, is always joyful, and is always perfect, and is always growing. I'm going to use the Trent graph here, the Trent chart. There's this growth. We have this idea that I get saved, smooth sailing, and I'm just getting closer and closer to God with no setbacks. But he says, actually, we get saved, and we go up, and then down, and then down, and then 2008 happens, and then this, and then 2012 happens, and whatever the years are for you. And then we look at our lives sometimes, we go, am I even saved? And God says, yeah, but you need to come back to me because you're not living in the joy that you can have because you're disobeying my commandments. That's what happens to Christians. Non-believers do the church thing, but they don't take God seriously. So we have to ask ourselves that question. Even St. Peter told us to ask ourselves that question. Examine yourself to see if you're in the faith. Paul said something similar. Look in your own heart. Look to see whether you're really there. Because if Christ is really in us, then there is no condemnation. But if we're just playing the game, there remains condemnation. Your mortal body will sin. You will have sinful desires that linger as a Christian. And let me tell you this. That does not diminish God's love for you one bit. As a Christian, you will sin, and it will be sin, and God will not be pleased. But his love for you will never change. We even see that in evil fathers, of which I am one. My children are sinners. If you don't believe in the doctrine of depravity, come stay at my house for a little bit, because my house filled with depravity, sinfulness from the point of birth, including me. But when, let me turn this around in a way that I wasn't going to use it. When I sin against my children by being a jerk, their love for me does not diminish. I'm always amazed by this. Travis Vick told me this one time. He said, the good thing about children is children and pets, they always forgive you. Well, not cats. They're a totally different thing. But anyway, children and dogs, maybe is what he said. They forgive you. And I have sinned against my children. What's the word? I have provoked my children to wrath. I have sinned against them. But when I go to them and I say, look, honey, I'm so sorry. I shouldn't have done that. You know what they do? They immediately say, it's okay, Daddy. And they hug me. It's okay. Last Sunday, after I told you about the issues that one of my children has, last Sunday night at the prayer meeting, I was praying for God's help as a parent, and Dana came to me and said, I need your help downstairs with one of your children. And I had to go put her in that restraint hold. And there were people outside the room praying, and it was really a difficult moment until she realized that she was wrong. And she had to be restrained, but she started doing the human equivalent of repentance. She said, while she was still laying on the floor, spread out, Daddy, can I hug you? I said, yeah, baby, come on, give me a hug. Then I started singing Randy Travis to her, I'm going to love you forever. I didn't know people were outside the door, okay? But it really became this sweet moment that involved the church, because I go outside and there are people there praying for me, and they're crying, and I'm crying, and I wasn't crying until I saw them crying, and then I was really crying. But here's the picture. God's grace is so much more perfect than my love for my daughter or her love for me. And the forgiveness is so much more complete than my love for her or her love for me. And God has not only given us that kind of love that is perfect, he's given us people who will be outside the door with us, the church, praying for us. When you sin against God, Christian, his love for you does not diminish one bit. However, we don't want to miss this point that the Bible is clear. The Holy Spirit is who does that in our hearts. The Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of God will give you the power in your mortal body to resist sin. And it transforms the law. The law can't save you because it can't undo sins, but Jesus undoes sin. He takes them away. And so then the commands of God don't become a burden. They become an expression of gratitude for the salvation that he has brought to us at great price. Why should you obey God if good works don't get you to heaven? Because it is an expression of gratitude for the salvation that he brought to us at great price. Coming to a humble state of a human who was born in a barn or a cave or a stable, who lived a difficult life, who was persecuted, and who was brutally crucified for our sins so he could rise from the dead and save condemned sinners like you and me. That's the gospel. Don't miss out on it. Let's pray together. God, we are grateful to you, as always, because you have allowed us to have this time together. And I pray that you would strike from our minds the words that came from me, and that you would let us remember the words that came from your Holy Spirit, your word, and your truth. God, thank you for your kindness this time, this morning, in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask that you would stand and continue to worship with us as we sing together.
You deserve the greater glory.
Thank you for being here to honor Miss Joanne. At this time, we normally have our deacon come and pray, but Chad Pendergraft is here, and I'm going to ask him if he will come forward. I mean, you just have to tell me no publicly if you're okay. He's coming. And Chad Pendergraft was the pastor here for somewhere between 5 and 20 years a while back, and he's loved and appreciated. So I wanted you to dismiss us in prayer. Thank you, brother. Oh, and also remember, this is not about you. There is a reception downstairs for Miss Joanne. We want you to come stay a part of that, and it's also a fundraiser for our youth. So just come and celebrate Miss Joanne and for who she is. Now I'll turn it over to Chad.
All right, let's pray. Father, it is good to be with your people in your house on your day singing your praise. What a treasure it is to be a part of the body of Christ. What a treasure it is to call you today, Lord and Savior. God, I pray and trust we have honored you today. We pray that, Lord, you would bless the remainder of our day together as we fellowship and spend time around the table honoring Miss Joanne. We pray, Father, that the name of Jesus would continue to be high and lifted up in this place and give us safe travels as we go to our homes. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.